Okay. So, as a part of today's demo agenda, so these are the points we are going to discuss. We'll talk about Oracle Fusion applications and what is the meaning of cloud computing, and what are the different delivery models are available from Oracle for the clients, and what is the difference, primary difference between on-premise and cloud platforms. And we'll see the few differences in terms of technology, functional, and application naming convention change, naming convention, how that got changed when you compare with EBS. And we'll just see the look and feel of Fusion applications, few slides I have to take you through. And finally, we'll go through the course curriculum. Okay, this is the agenda we have for today's demo. And once we complete, apart from this, if you have any questions, you can raise. Anyway, we have a few more, two more sessions to talk and understand about Fusion applications before we get into the actual application related practice. Okay, the first point here is Oracle Fusion applications. Okay, what is the meaning of Oracle Fusion applications? To understand that point, let's look into few ERP products which are available in the market. So we know we have a JD Edwards, PeopleSoft, CBL, Oracle, EBS suite. So when you look at, just I take in this, this few ERP products just for our discussions. We know we have many other ERP products in the market. But when you look at any ERP product, you can see that ERP product will be specialized in specific area. You may not see one ERP product which is specialized in the all the areas. That ERP product may not be famous for all the areas of business. If you take Oracle EBS, okay, the Oracle EBS, out of all the product solutions, financials are very famous, we know that. The same way, if you take example CBL, CBL is very popular product for CRM solution. Okay, CBL CRM. The same way, PeopleSoft, HCM, Human Capital Management. See, the CBL is offering many other areas of solutions. So they're offering, so enterprise resource management, ERM, and partner relationship management. So they're offering the different solutions. But when you talk about CBL, that is very famous for customer relationship management, CRM. The same way, PeopleSoft, they're offering supply chain management, human capital management, financial management, and supplier relationship management. Different solutions they're offering. But out of all these solutions from PeopleSoft, HCM, human capital management, HCM is very popular. The same way from JD Edwards, so procurement and order management process are very much popular in the market. So if any client want to go with the ERP product, and if they, as per their business process, what they are doing, if they are looking for best ERP, it's very difficult to find out. So that is the reason now most of the companies, what they do is, what is their primary business process? They'll look at that, and to support that primary business process, which is the best ERP, they'll be opting. Along with that, what are the other areas of business they're running to support the, from the same product, they'll be choosing the solutions. So to sub, if you take simple example here, so this is a client requirement. Say the client is looking for SCM, HCM, CRM, and financial management and reporting solution. So now, which is the right ERP to choose? So it's a big question. So if they want to go with the, if they for their financials, first let's go with this financials. For financials, they have to take the license from Oracle. And for their CRM solution, they have to take the license for CBL. For their HCM solution, they have to take the license from PeopleSoft. For order management and procurement, they have to take the license from JD Edwards. It would be very expensive and a big challenge for any company to go to take the license from the different vendors and to just integrate all the different products and managing and just providing the support in the process of usage. It will be a big challenge for any client. So that is the reason. So what Oracle it is, they acquired many ERP products. Okay, Oracle acquired many ERP products. Already Oracle is having the ownership on Oracle eBusiness Suite. That is their own product. Apart from that, Oracle acquired JD Edwards. So after acquisition, like it's Oracle JD Edwards in the same way. PeopleSoft also Oracle acquired. Now PeopleSoft is Oracle PeopleSoft in the same way. Siebel and Hyperion, which is a reporting tools, and Primavera project management. So not only these products, there are many other products Oracle acquired. If you see here, JD Edwards, PeopleSoft, Siebel, eBusiness Suite, these comes under ERPs, and Hyperion is a reporting tool, not only for reporting, it's a budgeting, planning, and reporting. We can use it, financial management, and Primavera for project management. So just I mentioned very few products here. So there is a very big list to understand what are the products Oracle acquired. Okay, so from their acquisitions, what they did is, from each and every ERP product what they acquired, they taken the best solution. From each and ERP product, they taken the best solution. So this is how, like, see, these are the Oracle products. From, say, JD Edwards, they taken Oracle, I mean, order management and procurement solution. From PeopleSoft, they taken the HCM, human capital management solution. From Siebel, they taken CRM solution. From Oracle EBS, they taken financial solution. From Hyperion, they taken all these HFM, okay, and Hyperion financial reporting, Hyperion planning and budgeting. And from Primavera, they taken PPM, project portfolio management. By taking these different solutions from the different ERP or other enterprise applications which are acquired by Oracle, they built application called as Fusion applications. Okay, so in the Fusion applications, the financial solution which you see, that is from Oracle EBS only. And within the Fusion applications, okay, the procurement and order management process which you see, that solution from JD Edwards. And within the Fusion applications, what are the HCM, human capital management, that is from PeopleSoft, and the CRM solution from Siebel, and reporting solutions from Hyperion, and projects PPM, project accounting, which we call in EBS case, that so we they taken from the Primavera, some, and the rest they taken from EBS also. So that's how, when you look at a product called as Fusion applications, they fused many other ERP best solutions into one product, that name is Fusion applications. So now when you are going to use Fusion applications, you see, you'll see all the products as a Fusion applications only. They are not mentioning anywhere. So this is just a JD Edwards solution, PeopleSoft or Siebel or Hyperion or EBS. So it may be from different ERP products, the solutions may be different from different ERPs, but once after taking those solutions into Fusion, just you can find everything as a Fusion applications only. But the background is the actual solution they taken from different ERP products. Okay, that is the meaning of Fusion applications. Any question on this, please? So any question on this to understand what is the meaning of Fusion applications? Fine. Just we'll move on to next slide. So cloud computing. So what is the meaning of cloud computing? When you talk about cloud computing, just these are the points which we'll be considering: the servers, internet, shared, okay, and the data, and it's just some network service providers. There are many terms will come into the picture. So just to understand what is the meaning of cloud computing, here we have a simple definition. When you say cloud computing, this is a practice of using the using a network of remote servers hosted on the internet to store, manage, and process the data, rather than a local server or personal computer will serve the requirements. What is the meaning of it? As we know, like in EBS case, normally if any say, for example, there is some XYZ client, they want to go with a EBS implementation, say for finance and SCM and HRMS. So in that case, what the client will do is they'll buy the server infrastructure, and they'll get the technical team to install and manage that server, and finally that will do the implementation, they'll start using. That means The client will take the license from the specific vendor. In our case, say Oracle. The client has to take, our customer has to take the license from Oracle. Once they take the license, they have to buy the server infrastructure. They'll buy the server infrastructure. First point is they'll take the license. Second point is they'll buy the server infrastructure. The third point is they have to get the all the technical team, say DBA and other networker security administrators and all, they have to get. Okay, then this team will work on it and they'll get ready with the instance. And as a part of implementation, the functional team and technical team do the implementation. So during that implementation, after once implementation is done, when the client is going to use, the servers need to be maintained by client team only. Okay, what are the team they deploy for the server maintenance and say DBA primarily we call. So they have to manage and they have to bear all the risk if there is something goes wrong and all. So this kind of practice we call as on-premise. Instead of going with on-premise, in cloud computing, what we can do is, say for example, one company wants to use financial applications. In that case, they no need to take the license in case of cloud computing. In cloud computing, what happens is, so say for example, Oracle. So you want to use Oracle financial applications. So in that case, instead of taking the license, you can take the subscription. You can take the subscription from Oracle saying that we want to use Oracle financials for our company. They'll give the subscription. After giving the subscription, so they will be providing the server access. That means servers will be managed by Oracle only. Servers will be managed by Oracle. So when you are going to manage the servers, okay, where you will be locating your servers? Definitely will be locating in specific location. That means you are going to, when you take the license from Oracle, you will get a software. That software will be installing in some local servers. Okay, physical servers, say physical servers. So you'll be locating the server in a specific location and you'll be installing. But in case of cloud computing, so we never take the license, just we'll take the subscription. Based on our subscription, Oracle will provide the access to the respective applications. They'll provide the login credentials and all. Then you can start accessing that relevant application. For which application you take in the subscription, you can configure and you can start using. So in this case, you no need to buy the server infrastructure. You no need to deploy the technical team to manage the servers. Just you have to pay for subscription, then you can start using. Before using anyway, that has to be implemented as per the client requirement. So client will take the subscription and the implementation team will complete the implementation. Then users will start using in this process. So Oracle is going to maintain the servers. Oracle is going to do the DBA activities. Even any patch application required also Oracle team only will be doing. You don't need to have a DBA to do the patch applications, to take the backup or cloning or any sort of DBA activities will be done by Oracle team or Oracle cloud team. So here, in case of physical servers, the physical servers will be located in a specific location. But in case of cloud computing, where your servers will be residing? The cloud computing company will use that technique called as physical servers. Okay, as per our subscription, they will create the virtual servers. The virtual servers, they'll be just keeping available an internet as a source. So wherever you have an internet connectivity access, you can think like your servers are available over there. In case of physical servers, say server is residing in US, the users are connecting from India and different other countries. So in that case, there could be some delay in terms of sending the request where server will receive and it will respond. Okay, there could be some issues. But in case of cloud computing, the servers physically are not going to be located in specific location. The servers, virtual servers, will be residing as a internet as a source. So from any time, from anywhere, the user can get connected to the server and the response and user experience will be very rich when you compare with on-premise. And again, when you go with a license, you have to spend a lot of money. In case of subscription, the subscription charges will be very less. So that is another advantage. We'll see more detail level how this on-premise cloud are totally different. But this is a point just to understand what is the meaning of cloud computing. Cloud computing, the customers can take the subscription. They no need to take the license for the product. Based on the subscription, the cloud computing company will provide, give you the access to the product. Then we can configure and we can start using the maintenance, server maintenance activities. All will be taken care by that specific vendor only. So this is the point we have to understand. We'll just move to other slides. Then if you have any questions, definitely we can discuss. Okay, cloud computing, just where you will be, your servers will be will be available as internet as a source. Okay. So here, what is the meaning of Oracle Cloud? Such kind of cloud services are provided by Oracle. Okay, when you talk about cloud computing, okay, here the meaning is, we'll take the subscription, the servers will be maintained by specific cloud vendor, and we'll access, we'll use, maintenance also will be done by cloud computing company only. So here the term is Oracle Cloud. What is the meaning of Oracle Cloud? The same services are provided by Oracle also. So now, if you want to use Oracle applications, you can take the subscription from Oracle and you can start using that product. All the maintenance activities will be done by Oracle only. You no need to get your technical team. You no need to buy any server. Servers will be managed by Oracle. For your subscription, they will be generating the virtual servers. Okay, the other point is they will maintain the big servers, where the big servers can create the virtual servers as per the customer requirements. Okay. And when you are going with the cloud computing, what are the different options are available for the customers? Say your company is going to they want to use Oracle Fusion applications. So if they want to use Oracle Fusion applications, so what are the different options to adapt from Oracle? So here we have a three options. In any cloud computing, not only Oracle, if there is some cloud computing company who are offering the cloud services, basically these are the three options which you can see. The first one is SaaS. SaaS stands for Software as a Service. The second one is PaaS. PaaS stands for Platform as a Service. Third one is IaaS, Infrastructure as a Service. What is the difference between these three? Okay, these makes big difference whether you can do the customizations or not, what are the product you are accessing from Oracle. So if you take example of SaaS, Software as a Service, generally, so if you go with this SaaS, Software as a Service, so you can get the subscription, when you take the subscription, Oracle will provide the instance access. Basically, in case of Fusion, the instance we call as a pod, P-O-D, pod. We have iPod, similar to that, is Fusion pod. Okay, so you can call as instance, but normally in case of Fusion, that's a term generally we use, we call it as a pod. So Oracle will provide the pod, you can have access and you can configure and you can start using. But if you want to do the customizations are not allowed for this SaaS subscription. Who are taking the SaaS subscription, okay, they cannot do any customizations to the product. But customizations are allowed for report customization. Report customization is different. Some certain functionality customization is different. So in case of SaaS model, you can develop the custom reports, but not custom functionality. And you can do the third-party integrations also. In case of Fusion, to do the third-party integrations, we have a web services, okay, which you can do as a part of middleware. In the middleware, we have a SOA, S-O-A, service-oriented architecture. Through that, by using the web service or many other options we have, you can do the customizations. In SaaS, you can do the third-party integrations and you can do the report customizations, but functionality-related customizations are not allowed. When you talk about PaaS model, in PaaS model, you can do any customization. The difference between SaaS and PaaS is here, you cannot do any functionality-related customizations, but in case of PaaS, you can do any functional-related customizations also. And in both cases, you can do the third-party integrations. And in two cases, you can do the report customizations. So PaaS advantage is functionality-related customizations also you can do it. And altogether, if you want to develop on custom applications, how normally we do in EBS, that is possible in PaaS. What is the other difference between what is the advantage of SaaS and what is the disadvantage of PaaS? If you go with the SaaS model, since you are not going to do some functional related customizations, okay, what happens is, say for example, now you are going to subscribe the Fusion applications with the SaaS option from Oracle. So today, say they are running the release 10, for example. Tomorrow, they are going to come up with release 11 by doing some announcements or by adding some new functionality. The clients who are using the SaaS subscription, they no need to upgrade. Automatically, Oracle will do the upgrade since everything will be in their control. Okay, they are the servers and everything we are accessing from Oracle only. They will be doing the upgrade, auto upgrade, Oracle will do it. But if you go with the past, since you are doing the customizations, this environment can be upgraded automatically to latest versions. So we know what practice we follow in case of EBS to do the upgrade. The similar practice we have to implement in case of PaaS. So PaaS advantages, customizations you can do. This SaaS disadvantages, you cannot do the customizations. Okay. The SaaS advantage, other advantage is it will be open for auto upgrades, but the PaaS environment cannot be upgraded automatically to the latest versions. Okay. Here we'll get the application access. Here also we'll get the application access. Here you cannot do customizations. Here you can do. Here auto upgrade possible. Here it is not possible. And what is the IaaS? So along with the product, along with the product for which products you are taking the subscription, Oracle will allow you, okay, to install some additional applications into that environment. Say you take in the subscription from Oracle, okay, request you all to mute. I could hear some noise. I'm sorry, please go ahead.
SaaS and PaaS.
Sorry, we lost your question. Could you please repeat?
Sorry. What's the difference between SaaS and PaaS with respect to the hardware that is hosted by Oracle or by the client?
That's what we're discussing. So when you say cloud computing, nothing is going to be managed by client, Oracle only. Okay.
Okay, so what exactly is platform as a service in platform. Terms of the hardware?
Yeah, when you say platform, Oracle, in case of PaaS, Oracle provides the platform which allows you to do the customization. Okay. They'll provide you the platform. Here, platform means it's just option. That's what you have to understand. They'll provide you the platform which allows you to do the customization.
So is it any physical entity? Platform means any server or separate license or what exactly is this platform?
That provision, it's just additional provision, that's it. Okay. Additional provision which allows you to do the customization. They'll be giving that some additional privileges where you can have access, and that is a place where you can do the customizations and you can deploy. In case of SaaS, you don't get access to that.
Hello.
Yep.
Yeah, I have a question. Suppose, as you said, that in case of SaaS, we cannot do any customization, but it happens in
every... See, the point is... One second. The point is, I'm not saying you cannot do the customizations. I'm saying functionality related customization, so you cannot do, that's it.
My doubt is, like in case of hardware, in the projects where I am working, we have the database access and we can write select scripts and we can do. So in SaaS, this is possible, like we would have the read-only access and we can write select scripts and we can do our analysis from the backend.
Yeah.
Is it possible or even that is not possible?
Yeah. I got your point. In SaaS or PaaS, you can have a database access. You can write the queries, you can write the some syntax, you can fetch the data and you can analyze, or else you can create the new custom report. Okay, that is possible. Yeah. But in case of EBS, you can just have a database connectivity from the different third party tools. Take as a best example, Toad. Okay, you can just connect to Toad. From Toad, you can just query the data and you can analyze and you can just have a communication with the database. That is not possible in case of cloud. Okay. Within that application itself, the web framework they are providing, within that framework only you have to write the queries and you have to analyze whatever you want to do. Within the application only you have to do, third party connectivity is not.
Okay. Another question. As you said that in case of SaaS, if Oracle is coming with a new upgrade, then it upgrades automatically. So I am assuming like on mobile we have an app, sir.
New version. If Oracle is going to come up with a new version, that can be.
Yeah, right. So the way I am thinking is like in our mobile we have an app and it gets upgraded, so we get the latest version. So will it be like this?
Same.
Or
yeah, exactly, same. Exactly. That is the best example we can take. One second. So why you are able to upgrade with just one click? Say simple, you will get an alert. Do you want to upgrade to latest version? If you say yes, automatically that will get upgraded. Reason is, so within your mobile, what are the software you have, the operating system, whatever, it's not customized by you. However, the service provider, okay, given as it is you are using, that is the reason you will get that option where it can be upgraded to latest version automatically. That's how the SaaS works.
So here my question is, suppose I'm a system administrator for my client or for my company and we are implementing Fusion and I got the alert that the upgrade has come.
No.
And I'm clicking yet.
No, one second. It won't happen same as a mobile, like alert you don't get it. So Oracle will be releasing that latest release and all that. We have to know and we have to send a request to Oracle. We have to write SR to Oracle saying that we want to just upgrade to latest version. If you are on the SaaS model, then they'll be scheduling. They'll be asking us time when just what, I mean, they'll be telling these many hours this upgrade activity will take place and we'll have a communication and we'll be scheduling. Based on our request and the schedule time, they'll do it. It's not like as much as upgrade in our mobile.
No, that part is fine. My doubt is, suppose the new version has come from Oracle and there are some features which is impacting my functionality, or I know that my users will not take it very friendly manner. So will I have a check? Can I, like it happens in ERPTREE, that we do some we do some regression testing, we tell our users.
You can do that. You also will get the different instances. Okay.
It won't be like one fine morning as a user I'm coming and I saw that my screens have changed and everything.
No.
It won't be like that.
No, that should not be like that. So it's organization decision. So definitely the communication takes place in the organization. Say yes, you are planning to upgrade to latest version. So definitely the management should take the decision that has to be communicated to Oracle. They'll be scheduling, they'll be communicating with the business users and who are the key people who has to get involved in this. That's how it happens.
Okay. And we can control it, like I want to say that the new update, I want to first see in test systems. If fine, then I will move to prod. So those type of controls I would be having. Right?
That is the actual process which you have to follow. Same happens.
Yeah. Right. Fine, thank you.
First, they'll be just your cloned environment only, they'll do this upgrade activity. Then you can do all the regression testings and etc. Some changes which are impacting reporting, etc. All these points. Then, once you will be conducting some workshops to the business users, and you may take some, it is going to release many features. You'll be taking all. You know, upgrade practice, how you do, the same will do.
Right.
Here, in case of EBS, our DBA will do it. But in case of Fusion, Oracle DBA will do it. If it is SaaS model, what are the big practice we do in case of EBS and taking care of the customers, etc., that no need to do it. It's a simple process.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. Fine. So, it's all about SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS.
So, Laxman.
Yeah. Please.
Yeah. So SaaS Oracle DBAs will manage the database activities. So how practical it is, like in case my user wants to know, like, is my request doing any IO? Are there any blocking requests? So do I need to get these details from Oracle itself by raising SRs?
Yes.
Like how practical it is?
Yeah, correct, correct. So whatever communications will have with your DBA in case of EBS, that you have to do with Oracle now.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Fine. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Okay. So this is just very high level. We'll go more detail level. Just very important points we are discussing here. We'll go more detail level to understand detailed information. That's all about SaaS, software as a service. You can do only report related customizations and you can have third party integrations, but functionality related, okay, customizations you cannot do. Here PaaS will allow for functionality related customizations. IaaS will work as a PaaS only. The additional advantage is within the same server you can install some third party applications also. That is additional advantage which you can have. We'll move to the next slide that gives more information on this. So when you talk about SaaS, it's just you can consume, you can use. So as a part of that, you'll have a servers. As a part of SaaS subscription, you'll have applications, you'll have your operating system, and you'll have a servers. Okay. So this applications will be consuming, you'll be using. You'll pay something and you'll be subscribing. And you'll be using that application as per your requirement. You'll configure and you'll start using. In case of PaaS, platform as a service, you can do the customizations, you can build. That is the scope you'll be getting. So if you compare these two slides here, so operating system and servers will be managed by vendor, but application you can manage on your own. That's how the scope, the option they'll be giving. Okay. So servers and operating system you cannot touch in case of PaaS. So PaaS will allow for the customization. That means the application customizations you can do. So, but this everything will be in their control only, the cloud vendor. But here in case of PaaS, so here you can have your own control where you can manage that new customizations or new application development and everything can be deployed. That is advantage of PaaS. And when you talk about IaaS, here just we are going to take hosting. They'll provide the server, you know, Amazon Web Services. You can take that hosting and you can install any application, any software, and you can start using. This is that sort of service which Oracle also offers. You may take the just server infrastructure, just you may take the server access, and since you are going to use Oracle applications only, you can talk to them. They'll be deploying that server, I mean applications also into this environment, and you can start using. And if you want to install any other applications also, you'll be able to install into the same server and you can use it. That's how it works. Here the additional advantage is new applications also you can install into server. But in case of PaaS or SaaS, you cannot install anything. Whatever the products you are taking the subscription, those products only you can manage and you can use from the respective hosting services. That's how it works. Based on this slide, any question, please?
I have a question.
Please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Hello. Yeah. My doubt is, suppose I want to implement
fusion. Your voice is not clear. Your voice is very low and not clear. I'm sorry.
Is it clear now?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. My question is, suppose I want to implement fusion for one of my client, and there the requirement is that we have integration with. Third party in the form that we get some files from some other application and we want to upload those files and that would get converted into AP invoices or AR invoices. So these type of functionality can I configure under SaaS?
Yeah, possible. Model? In any model possible.
Okay. But I think this in R12 we have to do a customization for this.
Here also you have to do the customize. Through customizations only you can achieve. Okay.
But you said that in SaaS we cannot do functionality customization.
See, this doesn't come under functionality. It's integration, right? Are you developing
yes.
functionality? No. You are just bringing the data from third party system to Fusion application. That we never call as customization.
Yeah, but I need...
That is integration.
But I need... Right. But I need to develop an interface which would, pick the file from a different and I need to write the code. I mean like in R12 it happens I need to write the code
I got your point. That's all about the integration. When you talk about any integration you have to write the programming, you have to develop the sub interface.
Yes.
That is there. The same we'll be doing by using the SOA, service oriented architecture. In Fusion we have a middleware, so within that we have web services. By using that, all these mappings can be done. Okay,
so for this purpose we need technical consultants, right?
Exactly.
That will be also.
Who knows SOA, service oriented architecture. Okay, so straight away we cannot deploy our EBS technical consultants for this work. The way how we do totally different.
Okay,
fine. Okay. But we will be covering those points also for our discussions. Okay, fine. So the same again, those three deployment models: SaaS, PaaS, IaaS. So if you just look into this SaaS, that will consist of application, security, database, operating system, virtualization, server, storage, network, data center. This all will be managed by vendor. If you go with a PaaS, the applications can be managed by you as a client. The rest of all will be managed by vendor. In case of IaaS, the operating system, virtualization, all will be managed by vendor. For these three, you will have access: application, security, database. So in case of Oracle, they are not giving any access to operating system, since you will be using the Oracle products only. But the normal general practice of IaaS is you'll have access to operating system. You'll have operating system choice also, but in case of Oracle, they are not giving. So you'll be using the applications which will be provided by Oracle, and but you can manage your security and database complete control you will be having. So this and all you can do in case of IaaS. So you now in the market, most of the customers are using SaaS only. Okay, even it is not allowed for customization, there is a great advantage of auto upgradation to latest versions. So most of the clients are using SaaS option. So this is a point here to understand. Any questions on this, please?
So one question.
Yeah, please.
So in SaaS, does it also allow auto upgrade for the hardware installations as well, or only for version upgrades?
See, the hardware and all, that's all about Oracle decision. Okay. They always will be upgrading to latest hardwares and all that, they'll take care of. But here as a client, we always look at our product related upgrades. We can think
because there are certain hardware which company thinks of improving the performances as well over the time.
Definitely,
so that can also be,
since it's a cloud services, they will be giving much importance to the performance. That is an advantage of cloud also. Definitely, they'll be definitely working on that aspect all the time. But
okay.
we never have any option to choose hardwares or to just interact with Oracle to upgrade. Okay, that we won't be having any privileges. When you go with the SaaS, so you can request Oracle to upgrade your application to latest version.
Mm-hmm.
Whether that hardwares can be upgraded or need to be upgraded or not required, when they will be having their own schedules and plans, that we cannot get into that discussions with Oracle or any other cloud computing company also.
Okay.
Application upgrade, yes, we'll have a rights to ask them to upgrade to latest version if available.
Okay.
Yeah. So any other questions here, please?
Hi, Lakshman. One.
Yeah, please.
So if we have some custom forms, or if there is a need to modify, let's say, an ADF form in Fusion, which infrastructure, which type of model suits for such a customization?
I have to go with the PaaS.
Can you please go to the previous slide, Lakshman? In that slide, it showed that middleware is owned by the vendor. Yeah, here, the middleware is owned by the vendor in PaaS. And since the form data is all, it resides in middleware, how will we be able to customize it?
See, middleware means here you have to understand as the operating system. So customizations and all belongs to your application. So application will have access to build what are the customizations you want to do. that comes under application, not operating system. Ignore the term called as middleware. It's a very generic light. It's not exactly representing our fusion. This is our actual fusion. This is a slide, which you can understand. Operating system. So here they give the naming comes from middleware or operating system. So here the same operating. So just see operating system to run that applications, to hold that all the applications. So with that, you don't need to do anything. Just when you talk about the consultant point of view, applications are important for us, right?
Okay, okay. So unlike e-business suite, the form server, the web server, the HTTP server, they are not existing in the middleware in Fusion Cloud.
Yeah, we have seen for that instead of using Apache and all other servers, they came up with a WebLogic server now. And there are many other servers to run different, for BA separate server. We got many servers to support different areas of application running. Okay, so just if you want to do the customizations, you need access to this applications only. That is possible in case of PaaS.
Okay, and Laxman, will you also be explaining what is the architecture of this Fusion Cloud, like the structure, etc.
Understand that what is the architecture of Fusion, what are the layers we have, what level, what information can be managed, and what is the enterprise structure in the Fusion applications. We'll be discussing all these points.
Okay, sure, yeah. That will be helpful. Thanks.
Yeah, definitely will do it. Thanks.
Hi.
Yeah, please.
Hi, I'm Deji, and I have a question. Which is the methodology, implementation methodology for these models?
No, I'm sorry, I could not get you. Can you be a bit loud?
Yes, which is the methodology? Because you explained that before to start the use, you need implementation.
Correct.
Which is the methodology for implementation?
When you say methodology, it's a very simple. That's all about their own decision, the consulting company decision. Their PMO can decide. Okay, project management office. You take example of EBS. So you can see the clients, you can see the few projects which definitely they're running on OUM methodology, Oracle Unified Methodology. Okay, and few other clients, for a few other projects you may see, they'll be going with their own methodology, right? So when you are going to the Fusion implementation, they can use OEM or they can use their own practice, but ultimately we should achieve all the capturing all the information, their current business process, solution design, and just mapping all need to be captured in the systematic way through documentation. For that, normally the preferable method is the latest one is OEM. Otherwise, the company may go with their own methodology here and there, which is a wrong practice, which you can see as no documentation in few projects. Okay, everything is there in the market, but so preferably we can go with the OEM, otherwise our own methodology.
Thank you.
Yeah, fine. So we'll just move on to next slide. Here it's all about any question.
Hi Laxman.
Please.
Hi Laxman.
Yeah.
I have a question. Can you please move on to the previous slide?
Yeah.
So, if we are operating something, is it interlinked with IaaS, PaaS, and SaaS? How it works?
I didn't get you. If we are?
If we are operating something, say for example, if we are doing something in IaaS, so is it interlinked with SaaS, and ultimately it will move to SaaS, like how it works?
No, these three are independent.
Okay.
You can go with only one option. Okay. Initially, as a client, you may go with the SaaS, and you may find the situation, so many requirements are not meeting with the standard product. Then you can switch from SaaS to PaaS, but not from PaaS to SaaS. Yeah, these three are very independent. Okay, if you are doing something that would falls into SaaS or PaaS or IaaS, there is no dependency, there is no interlinked process or operations. Yeah, you can see any client will be with the SaaS or PaaS or IaaS, not with some combination.
Okay.
Thanks. So it's only the difference is the privileges. Here no privileges to do the customization. Here we will get a privileges to do the customization. Here along with the customization, so you can manage the database and you can have a additional product installations also. That is the other advantage. That's it. Only client will go with one as per their requirement.
Laxman, if I may interrupt, nice example comes to my mind, which I saw in the somewhere in YouTube. So SaaS, you can assume like it is an Ola or an Uber service. PaaS is like a one day rented taxi, and IaaS is like your own car, something like that.
So that may be correct, but it may not exactly suits with this. See, it's all about three are, if you go with that example of own and all, it's three are rental only. Okay. The first one, three are rental, you will take subscription, rental base only. SaaS you can take on rental base and you should not change anything. You have to use as is. PaaS you can do certain changes. Okay. And IaaS you can do many changes within that.
Yeah, sure.
That's how. Okay, three are rental base. Nothing we are going to own. But whatever you are taking on rent base, subscription base, just what level of authority access, privileges we have, that makes difference. In case of SaaS, no authority. Just use as is. In case of PaaS, you can work on application. You can change application, you can do the customization. In case of IaaS, along with the customization, you can just have additional installations also into that. That's it. Fine. So now just let's look into these few points, which talks about the difference between on-premise and cloud. So here we have a on-premise application. In case of on-premise application, we just already we discussed these few points. CapEx upfront investment. That means in case of on-premise, you have to do the capital investment where you have to buy the server infrastructure. And if you are running the application on your own server, customer owned upgrades and patching. So upgrades should be handled by client only, customer only, and patching work also should be done by client team. So the data centers and hardware cost, including disaster recovery and all, you have to depend on some hardware centers where you have to ready to bear all these risks and all. So in case of on-premise, the customizations will become a bit costly. So in case of cloud, you can do customization within the application. They are providing the environment, which makes very easy to do the customizations and annual support. And so there are many outdated software resulting missed business benefits. So if you are going to run on-premise, simply whenever Oracle comes up with a new version, simply you cannot upgrade to that latest version. That's not that much easy. That is the reason the business may miss some announcement which are done by Oracle in the latest release or new functionalities which came up with a new latest release. So we can do the upgrades, but not whenever Oracle comes with the latest version. Since that is a bit challenge in case of on-premise. And again here, network and security access, everything should be managed by client. But when it comes to cloud, just you will be taking rent. Rent base will be taking that access and will be using. And security and access, you can have a security and you can access from anywhere whenever you require with more security and no upgrade, but latest functionality will be available. So these are the advantages you can see in case of cloud. Here you have to buy the server infrastructure, you have to take the license. Here no need to buy the server infrastructure, no need to take license also, just take subscription. So rent base you can start using. Okay, so here I mentioned the few technology related changes. So when I talk about servers, in case of EBS, we have Oracle App Servers, so simply you can call as Oracle Apache Server. And in case of Fusion, the applications will be running on Oracle WebLogic Server. And GraphQL User Interface. Okay, GraphQL User Interface. In case of EBS, we have Forms and JSP Pages. In few cases, they are given the web pages, right? for suppliers, customers, when you talk about financials. Okay, most of the functionality is managed with the forms only, but in few areas for supplier, customer, and bank accounts, right? So those you can create, you can define, and you can manage within the JSP pages. But when it comes to Fusion applications, there is no concept of forms in Fusion, completely ADF pages. Okay, ADF pages only will be using, no forms in Fusion. And workflows, when you talk about workflows in EBS, the workflows, if you want to customize or if you want to write any programming logic, you'll be using the PL SQL language. But in Fusion applications, you will be using the language called as BPL, Business Process Execution Language. BPL we call Business Process Execution Language. And reports, in EBS we have XML publisher. Now in Fusion we have BI publisher reports. For analysis purpose, we have Discoverer in EBS, but in Fusion we have OTPA. And other some functional changes, access, when you talk about access, to access anything in EBS, we'll use the concept called as responsibilities, but in the Fusion we use roles. There is a roles concept directly introduced. You don't find any responsibilities in Fusion application. We'll go detail level when you start working on that. And approvals. In case of approvals in EBS, we have an application called as AME, which will be managed with the workflows and all. In Fusion applications, we don't have any AME. AME is replaced with BPM, Business Process Management, okay, where you can run with the BPL, Business Process Execution. You can do all the customizations and you can manage. And when you talk about data migrations in EBS, we'll just do the data conversion activity where we depend on technical people. In case of Fusion applications, the data conversion or data migration can be done by functional consultant. Okay, data conversion can be done by functional consultant. If you take example, you have to load all the vendor master or open invoices and payables, or else customers data you want to load. In case of EBS, what we do, we'll just prepare the templates, we'll give it to the business users, we'll collect the data, that information will pass to technical people, they'll write the programming logic and they'll create the staging, they'll be just fetch the, they'll be moving the data from flat files to staging. They'll write many validations. Again, they'll write a lot of programming to move the data from staging to interface. From there, we can just by submitting the separate concrete program, we can import. This is how we'll be managing the data conversions or migrations in case of EBS. But in the Fusion, we don't need to do all these activity. We don't require any technical support also to do the data conversions. Being a function consultant, we can do by using FBDA templates, file-based data import. File-based data import. By using these templates, just we can, you don't need to prepare any templates also. All these templates also Oracle is providing. In case of EBS, we'll prepare the templates. But here, very much validated templates Oracle is providing. You can download from Oracle website. Those templates, give it to the business users. They'll fill with the data. By submitting to concurrent programs, you'll be able to get the data into base tables. No need to do any programming, no need to create the staging, no other validation, all validation Oracle built as a part of this FPDA. Anyway, this also we are going to execute in our classes. We'll see how to migrate the customers' data, suppliers' data, open invoices, open transaction receivables, assets. So all we are going to execute in our classes. We'll see that complete end-to-end process we will be doing also, not just discussing. And setups and configuration, in case of EBS, you have to do the setups. If you want to do the payables configuration, you have to be in the payables responsibility, receivables configuration. You have to do it from receivables responsibility or say receivables application. But in the Fusion applications, we have one centralized place which we call as FSM, Functional Setup Manager. From Functional Setup Manager, you can do any application related configuration. So here no switching is required. So any, as a part of implementation, you can have access to FSM. From FSM, you'll be able to do all the setups. Before that, it is a mandatory you have to create the project in Fusion applications. Anyway, we'll see those maybe within after two to three classes. So these are the few points to understand the application naming convention changes. If you see few points you can address here. In EBS, the applications financials, here you see financials. HRMS, that since they've taken the solution from PeopleSoft. As per PeopleSoft, we call it HCM, Human Capital Management. These are the very generic terms only, but just I mentioned. So whatever we are calling an EBS HRMS, here we are going to call it as HCM, human capital management projects suit what we have in EBS, that in Fusion we are calling as PPM. PPM stands for Project Portfolio Management, PPM. Okay, that's how we have. In case of EBS, we have a database which we call as Oracle database, but in Fusion we have a two databases. One is Oracle, other one is Sbase. What is the purpose and all, and we will be discussing. And the system administrator, here we have a different tools. Here this slide is not applicable, it's a previous version which I mentioned. Now for here, as a system administrator in Fusion we have these also, we have, but now Oracle is not giving the access from the release 12 for this Oracle Entity Manager and Authorization Policy Manager. Now they are giving access to Security Console, where you can do administrator related activities. Okay, to just have a look and feel of that application, this is how that navigator looks like. So now in the Fusion application, this is how navigator looks like. The user has access to which functionalities, which modules, all the privileges you can see here. From here, for example, you want to create the journals, directly you can click on journals. It will open the journals related dashboard. Within that journal related different activities you can perform. Okay, the same way, so different. This is how you can see the navigator, and this is the home page. This is all we call as springboard icons, based on what are the applications or functionalities this user has access. Those will get displayed here as a shortcuts. You can, by clicking on this, you can have access to certain functionality. Other option is navigator here left side. Okay, so you can click on this. This is a navigator icon. This is how it will open all these functions. You can select and you can proceed, or else the same will be available on the home page as a springboard icons. This we call a springboard. Within that, these are the icons which will be representing particular application or within the application specific function. Okay, so this is just a web page, ADF page for supplier creation, where we'll create the supplier. Then we have to create address, sites, contacts and qualifications. Okay, and this is not applicable, it's related to previous version, I forgot to remove that. So, and when you talk about course curriculum, these are the modules we are going to cover. Primarily we'll be working on Oracle Fusion General Ledger, Accounts Payables, Receivables, Cash Management, Fixed Assets. These are the five modules which we are going to cover, the major focus, and the rest Oracle Fusion Tax. This will complete the basic setups and will be testing in payables or receivables whether tax is getting calculated as per setups or not. And Fusion Expense, basic configuration and expense report creation, approvals and creating the invoice against that. And purchasing, okay. And purchasing application also will do the basic configuration and will be testing the requisition creation, purchase orders, receipts. And the inventory application in Fusion we call as product management, okay, or product information management. So here we don't call as inventory, just I mentioned in the bracket as a, so inventory part. And order management. And see, the simple point here, just to cover all this, we'll be working on P2P and O2C cycles also. We'll just configure the P2P and O2C cycle. We'll see the complete cycle. In case of P2P, creating the requisition, converting into PO, and creating the receipt and performing the delivery and creating the invoice by matching with the PO or receipt and making the payment. Anyway, that will be covering in the AP. And when you talk about O2C, creating the orders and booking the orders and performing the fulfillment for the orders, nothing but pick, leadership, confirmation. Finally, auto invoice creation, receivables. That's what we'll be covering as a part of P2P cycle. And AGS, Advanced Global Intercompany System. This also will be just covering in our classes. So whatever the points here we are discussing, everything we'll be doing from scratch. We are not going to discuss based on some existing definitions within the system. In case of fresh environment, we'll start from the scratch. So in the same approach we are going to follow in our classes also. Everything we'll be creating, we'll be configuring, and we'll do the setups, and we'll be working on the process so that we can have a better understanding and we can have a good command on the product related configuration process. So we are not going to use some existing definition like vision definitions or something else. So we already shared the detailed course content for the same, exactly what we are going to cover in GL, APR, CM, FA and all these applications, what exactly we are going to cover. Already we shared the course content. So if it is any chance it's missing from your end, then we will be sending once again. Okay, today this session we'll be sharing with everyone. Along with that session, recording video, we'll be sharing course curriculum once again with everyone. Okay. Yeah, please. Yeah.
Does the collections comes under account receivable?
No, that is separate module as EBS. Advanced okay. collection.
So, yeah, so advanced collection is separate.
Separate, yes, separate module.
So that won't be there in this course, right?
Yes, yes, exactly.
Okay.
I have a query here. Whether we are going to cover the workflow part and
yes, approval parts will be covering. So we'll be covering payables, invoice approvals, okay, and GL journal approvals, and when you are working on purchasing, requisition approvals and PO approvals, we'll be working on that.
And what was the identity manager, that part also will be covered? Or?
Identity manager is available in the older releases. See, I'll tell you that point. Mm-hmm. So I think the same slide I have here, right? See, identity manager. Okay. Or you can call as Oracle Identity Manager. When you say Oracle Identity Manager, we call as OIM. When you say Identity Manager, IDM, or else you can call as Oracle Identity Manager. Both are same. So now the version which we are going to use for our classes is 12, release 12, which is the latest. And these IDM, okay, IDM and OIM are both are same. This access you can get up to release 10 only. From 11 they changed. Okay, sorry. I mean till 11. I mean till 11 we have. Till 11 we have. Okay, till 11 you can have access to Identity Manager IDM, but from 12 they removed. What you can do in the Identity Manager? You can create the users. Primarily, you can create the users and you can assign the roles. That they restricted to IDM and they given the same privileges to do it from security console. The previous versions only you have to access to this. Now, latest from 12, completely Oracle stopped accessing to this IDM and to APM, Other Asian Policy Manager. Here, what happens is, what are the roles we'll be using in the Fusion? The templates you can maintain and you can create the custom roles also from here. So these are all what we can do from IDM and APM. The all the functionalities they move to security console in from release 12. Okay, that's all we have here. So any other questions, please?
Yes, hi Laxman, this is Raj.
Yeah, Raj, please.
Actually, my question is that what is that inbuilt tool of Fusion for running the SQL queries that you were talking about?
There is no tool. There is no tool. Within the application, we have a BI area, business intelligence, some framework area, dashboard we have. From there, we can run it. Just a simple.
Okay, from there, we can run the SQL queries, right?
Yes, yes, yes. We can run the SQL queries. I'll take you through that. So because we should know from where to run the SQL queries and all. So for that reason, I'll take you through that function. And once you run that query, that data, if you want to take into the report definition, how to create the report. So those points we'll see in our classes.
All right.
Yeah. So any other questions, please? So this is our detailed course content. Okay, so as a part of GL, these are the just basic setups we'll do, and these are the different concepts which we'll be working. All this SR, CVR, data asset, definition asset, and prime secondary ledger, reporting ledgers, auto posting, auto reversal, revaluation, translation, consolidations, and the reporting, Hyperion reporting, which we call as Hyperion financial reporting, smart view, account inspector, monitor. And as a part of payables, this is the configuration we are going to cover. And these are the concepts which we are going to handle for payables. So including this supplier conversion and the open invoices conversion. okay, and BI reporting, OTBI reporting, and as a part of receivables, this required configuration, and these are the different concepts which you are going to work on: invoice, credit memo, debit memo, chargebacks, receipts, receipt batch, reversals, reciprocal, customer, cross currency receipts, receipt write-off, customer refunds, revenue recognition, BFP, and conversion for customers onto auto invoice conversions, and reconciliations between AR and GL. And for cash management, these are the concepts for fixed assets and fusion expense. It's a very simple basic configuration, and the transaction process and purchasing, basic configuration and process, fusion tax, basic configuration process, FSM, functional setup manager, which you will be using to do any configuration. This only will come as admin part. This FSM and what I can say, like security console, these two will be using as a admin access. So Oracle Identity Manager, these two are not applicable. This course curriculum I prepared based on the previous version. So this OIM and APM are not applicable in release 12. Okay, so BPM will be working on the different approvals. The same course curriculum will be sharing with everyone. You can go through from your end. If you have any questions, definitely we can discuss. Any questions based on today's discussion, please?
Just for question.
Yeah.
The BI reports, you told that it will be created in OBI or in a different software?
BI reports?
Yeah.
Yeah, see, for BI reports, that actual the server, the BI will be, now the BI will be part of middleware, OBIE, that is the actual platform, and that this is the one of the function.
Okay. We would use OBIE or BI publisher?
BI publisher. We'll be using the BI publisher. BIP reports. Just I mentioned the BI reports. Is BIP only. BIP, Business Intelligence Publisher Reports. Yeah.
Will you also cover,
can you be a bit loud, please? Your voice is very low.
Will we also cover this security console part?
Yes, we'll be covering. We'll be creating the users, roles assignment, custom roles definition, all we have to do it. See, when you are going to work as a functional consultant for Fusion Financials implementation, what sort of information, no, that I'll be covering in the classes.
Thank you.
Yep, fine, thanks. Any other questions, please?
Just one more question. For consolidation, do we use HFM or Oracle standard functionality?
Oracle standard functionality only. See, HFM is a different purpose. If you have a data in the different formats, to just get into that actual structured format with respect to dimensions, we use HFM. Okay, HFM you can use with any applications, right? Hyperion, financial management.
Yeah.
Okay, that you can use for any application, but here, so that they given as inbuilt. Whenever you have a data in our EBS database, that will directly, with the help of HFM inbuilt functionality only, it will just flow into S-based database as a multi-dimensional queues, which will be required for reporting and Hyperion budgeting planning purpose. Even standard budget functionality also we are using the same.
Yeah.
We no need to do anything.
Our current organization.
We no need to do anything with that. That is inbuilt. The system will synchronize and it will support for the relevant processes. That's how they take into use.
Okay.
So any other questions, please? Okay. So these sessions will be running in the only weekends, Saturday and Sunday. So now just 8 to 10 o'clock, I mean, we'll be running for 8 to 10 o'clock. Since it's a kind of demo, we are just going to stop for now. And from next weekend, we'll be running for 2 hours. If you guys are okay, we can just run for more than 2 hours. In that case, we can prepone to 7 o'clock. So we'll plan in that way based on your flexibility. We can have a sessions. How many hours will be available to attend the classes? Those many hours I can take. I'll be available. No issues with that. So that's how we'll just make a plan and we can continue and we can close it as soon as possible. Okay, we are not going to fix the timings and ideally it would be for 2 hours. If you guys are okay, we can prepone it to 7 o'clock from 7 to 9:30 or 7 to 9, 3 hours. Saturday 3 hours, Sunday 3 hours, or else Saturday 2 and Sunday 2 hours, or two and off. However you require, we can just plan and we can execute. Okay, that's how we'll do it. So any other questions, please?
Laxman, a general question about migrating to Fusion from, let's say, EBS R12 or 11i. Supposing a client has many customizations.
Available. You are talking about upgradation or data migration?
Yeah, upgradation along with re-implementing the customization.
Yeah, see, upgradation is not available in for the Fusion. You cannot upgrade from EBS to Fusion. Solution is not available. Any client wants to move to Fusion from EBS, that would be re-implementation. Again, they have to do all the configuration. They have to do the conversion.
Okay, so clients that have been using EBS for a long time, maybe some decades, will they be willing to go to Fusion from their existing suite?
Yeah, few clients already did, who just implemented very recently EBS. They cannot switch. The clients who are using for many years, the few clients move to Fusion through the process of re-implementation.
Okay, so that will take a huge amount of time, right, to implement each and everything.
It's from simple, legacy simple. To see, I'll tell you the point. So product is going to be same, but environment is going to be different with a different release, right? So when client is using EBS, that means solution is finalized, right?
Yeah.
Only what you have to do is same configuration you have to do, okay, however you did in the EBS, and you have to move the data from EBS database to Fusion database. Primarily these two things. Rest, there are many. You may not find, you may not require too much of time. Apart from that, what are the new functionalities which you see in the Fusion which are not available in EBS, which they want to use? For that, you may conduct some workshop and you may take you through the process of usage and all. It won't take much time. Okay, if you have a client who is just more or less running with kind of a vanilla implementation, maybe with a few customizations. Maybe in the period as a part of re-implementation, you may complete within 3 to 4 months, not more than that. Even in a cloud case, 6 to 7 months, they are completing the projects. Okay, but again, depends.
Okay.
Again, depends the how much modules you are going to implement, for how many countries you are going to do this implementation. That change the time frames. Right, so but it's very normal, small and medium clients. So simply within the few months, you will be able to, you can make them to switch from EBS to Fusion with re-implementation.
Okay, so if client has lot of customizations, then Fusion is not advisable for them.
No, it's advisable. You can go with the PaaS, not SaaS.
Okay, but the client that I work for has lot of custom forms, custom PL SQL workflows, etc.
That you can.
So to re-implement all of this,
PaaS, right? PaaS supports.
But PaaS does not have any forms.
They can do one thing. If they have some security concerns when you talk about cloud and all, they can take the license for Fusion applications. They can install the Fusion applications in their own server. How you can play with EBS in the same way you can play with the Fusion then. Don't go with the cloud. Product remains same. If you are going to access from Oracle, that you call as a cloud. If you are going to place in our install in our server, and if you are going to use, that is on-premise. In case of on-premise, we call as Oracle Finance, Fusion Financials. If you're asking from Oracle, Oracle Cloud Fusion Financials, or Oracle Fusion Cloud Financials. That's okay.
Okay, hosting the application should be okay for now, but bringing in all the functionality is don't you think it's a little difficult considering Fusion does not have, you can't just copy a form from EBS to Fusion.
No, you are not going to copy, you are going to do the configuration. Say your client is using AP, already you designed the solution and you finalized and you implemented they are using, right? That means you have solution ready, right, for payables.
Yeah.
So for the same features, you do configuration once again in the Fusion and you present them how to use it, then they start using. Before that, load the master data, vendors and open invoices into payables. Then payables will be implemented in the Fusion and will be ready to use. That's all. Again, you are not going to gather
the data. No, not the requirement, Lakshman. What I'm trying to ask is, if there is a custom workflow in AP, in EBS, I will have to re-implement it using the BPL in Fusion, right?
How to do that?
Redo the UAT, everything, right?
Exactly. How to do it?
And this has to be done for each workflow, each interface,
they are going to use, everything is how to present to the users to educate them to understand.
Then I feel Oracle has come out with this Fusion only for smaller clients or newer companies. I would say this is not suitable for clients who are running EBS for decades.
See, they are building the solution to upgrade from EBS also to EBS to Fusion also. It may just come out very soon, but as of now, we don't have solution. However, you can upgrade from 11i to release 12 or within the release 12 from one version to another version. We have as an upgrade process, the same process they are working. If you see latest EBS applications, they included middleware concept also to support Fusion middleware. Okay, for upgradations, they'll come up with this very soon. Okay, so that's what they are working on it. So as of now, no client, EBS client can upgrade to Fusion since the solution is not available. If they are interested to go with the Fusion, only the option is re-implementation, where for a few clients has already happened.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Lakshman.
Yep. Thanks.
Any other? Lakshman, because one thing. So with all this discussion, what I understood as like a technical scope has been completely reduced.
Yes.
Is it?
We know in EBS, primarily we need, if you take example, you are doing some sort of vanilla implementation. Even if it is vanilla implementation, we require technical consultant for data conversion. But for data conversion, technical resources are not required. If most of the clients are using SaaS, in case of SaaS, customizations are not allowed. Because of these reasons, okay, the technical resource dependency is going to be drastically reduced. Now you can see the companies who are doing this cloud implementation. So if they have a 4 projects for cloud, say financials implementations only, for 4 projects, they may have 1 technical resource. That too, not EBS technical resource, who knows middleware. So BPL. These areas, they should be expertise. They'll be utilizing those resources wherever required. Accordingly, they'll be utilizing in the different projects. That is the scope for technical people now. See, we can see most of the technical guys are just migrating to functional. They are just moving to functional.
Okay. Yes. So I think technical resources have to move to functional now.
Right. They have a scope of going with a middleware components learning and all, but even in that case also they won't find good openings on that. There is no much scope, as we just now discussed, for multiple project, one resource enough to support the few technical aspects of work. So that is the reason most of the guys are just moving to functional side. So that's what I could see in the market, as well as there are many people who just taken the training also, whose background is completely technical.
Yeah.
I mean, to say like,
and instead of developing applications in PL/SQL and maybe forms, you will develop in ADF and Java.
ADF, that too, in which projects, if client is going to use pass model, right?
Yeah.
If client is going to use pass, then only the ADF developer is required. Otherwise, there is no need.
So Laxman, based on your experience, how many clients or how many Fusion implementation, out of all the Fusion implementations that are gone live, how many are SaaS, how many percent are PaaS, and how many percent are IaaS?
Okay, see, very big clients will go with the PaaS. If you see in the market, 10 Fusion implementations, you may not find one also PaaS model. Okay, if you look at the number, as 50 implementations are happening on cloud, you may find hardly one or two. So that's the ratio we have. So most of the clients are going with a SaaS model only, not with a PaaS. So in my experience, I have seen only one client now the implementation happening. That just doing that implementation for around 60 countries. They have operations more than 100 countries. So that sort of big client they are going to use. Earlier they are using the different ERPs. They were using Oracle, SAP, and different other ERP products also they are using for their entire enterprise operations. Now they are just going to move to Fusion. So that client, they are using this PaaS model. Apart from that, I didn't see any client who are using PaaS for the implementation.
Okay. And Laxman, suppose like for technical person, we should do like we should go for functional knowledge or like for ADF and all. What you suggest to come in Fusion?
So technical people, see, they can continue with the technical, but in that case, if they want to continue the technical, the primarily they have to learn ADF, then they have to learn BI and other few, some technical objects which are related to middleware, like say SOVA and BPL. Okay. And if they are going to learn these areas, then they can survive as a technical consultant in the Fusion. But the scope is very less. Okay. The scope is very less, and there are no many resource requirements in the market also, because of most of the clients are using only SaaS.
Okay. So means completely functional people are good with this Fusion. So there's a lot of scope for functional.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Lakshman, do you know if, I think this is from an architecture point of view, like if there are two clients who are using the SaaS model.
Can you be a bit loud, please? Your voice is very bit low. You don't
okay.
Know.
What I'm asking, like if there are two clients who are using the SaaS model,
okay,
of the same module, for example, AP.
Okay, okay.
Then the base table, will they share the same tables or there will be a separate set of table for each?
No, no, no. See, you know, like when you work on EBS case, what our DBA will do? It'll be just cloning. I mean, we'll be creating the multiple instances, right, in the same server. Test environment, and if required for UAT separate instance, CRP separate instance. This is how we'll have a different instance. That means it's all about copy of the same environment. That's how it works. The same tables are not going to be shared. The pods, PODS pods or POD pod, or say instance, will be maintained separately by Oracle. Okay.
Okay, for each client.
Yeah, for client-wise separate instance. But that would be very virtual. Servers based instances, They'll take care of the security. We don't need to worry about it. But the same table, same, no, that should not be. It won't work in that way.
Okay, I was thinking some sort of partitioning in those tables.
Yes. The complete instance, the complete pod, they'll be allocating separately.
Okay. Thank you.
Fine. Any other questions, please?
Just one question. So the cloning and other decision also can be taken by the finance functional team?
No, see, dependency on say your client is using the application, you are working for implementation. Anyway, implementation time may not be required, you are working on support. So just the client side, they have to see, again, when you go with the cloning, our DB, normally EBS or DBA will do it. But here, Oracle DBA is going to do it. For the cloning, they will be charging some amount. That means client has to take the decision. Client has to take the decision whether they want to clone that production to the test environment or not, or some other environment. That is a client decision.
So those rights are with Oracle team, vendor team, or with the internal DBA team?
Client has to accept. Say you are working as a consultant. You came up with the situation. There are many issues where you want to test in the test environment, but there is no proper data. It's not syncing with your production. So in that case, the requirement, maybe you may find that let's clone that entire production to other environment. Okay. So in that case, yes, you may speak to your project manager initial level. They may pass to client, or else if you have a such kind of rapport or communication with your client, you can talk to the client manager. Okay, or who's the right person, you can talk to them. Then they'll come up with a decision saying that whether how much it would be costing, and they'll talk to Oracle accordingly. If they are okay, then they'll say okay to us, then we'll be rising on SR to Oracle. Rise SR, saying that production pod we want to clone. Then that's how the communication happens. There will be phone conversations. So then that would get scheduled and they'll be doing it.
So they will be doing it.
Yeah, Oracle will be doing. Oracle will be doing in case of cloud. Yep.
Hello.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I have heard that
Ritvik, your voice is very low. I'm sorry, every time I'm just raising the same point. Your voice is very low. Please check from your end. No big difference.
Is it audible now?
Yeah, fine, better. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, I have heard that in case of fusion, if we are doing the rollout, then just we need to maintain the configuration in an Excel sheet and just upload it, and we can and the whole configuration would be done if it has been done for one base entity. Is it something like that?
See, we have an option to do a rapid implementation where you can just keep the information into rapid implementation spreadsheets. Basically, we call as RI. RI means rapid implementation. We can keep the data within those sheets that you can load into the system. That provision we have, but as a complete solution, you cannot execute. If you are going to roll out for new, the operating unit in EBS, we call in the fusion as a BU, business unit. For complete BU, you cannot perform the rollout with that sheets. And for a different country, you cannot do the rollout based on that existing configuration. Certain part of configurations and certain informations, you can load it. Load into the system, but not end-to-end solution. You cannot take with the advantage of this rapid implementation spreadsheets.
And another thing which I have heard that under the, I don't know under which model, but I have heard that under Fusion, even Oracle is completely from a totally business standpoint, even they are encouraging customizations to SRs. I mean, you can log in SR and the Oracle dedicated team will do the customization. And unlike R12, since the cost is very less,
I got your point. Answer is no. Implementation should be, customization should be done by your team. Okay. Oracle is not going to do customization for any client. Okay. If the clients are seeing, Oracle, you have a different division. We say, for example, we have one division called as on demand. Okay. If some client is interested to go with the on demand, however, they'll just give that service support contract to some company in the same way. Instead of going some with a XYZ company or ABC company, they can go with a Oracle on demand for support. In that case, they can request on demand to do it. If the on demand is doing, we should not take as Oracle will do it if any customization is required. That is separate team will be doing. See, in Oracle also we have a consulting division.
Okay.
So you might have heard that statement, but the normal.
No, actually, what I have heard is in Fusion Oracle is strictly discouraging the point of customization, and if any client really needs the customization.
I'm sorry, I can't understand. I'm sorry. Please, you have to fix that issue, and then we can talk on this. Okay.
Oh. Okay.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, Lakshman Vikas here. Last question from my side.
Yeah.
I'm continuing my previous question regarding technical and functional.
Yeah.
So right now I'm working in R12. So can I carry my functional knowledge of R12 to Fusion?
Yes.
How it will match? Means compatible?
Compatible. See, it's just you will be upgrading. So now you. See, whatever the experience you have, the product knowledge you have, the same you can utilize in the Fusion. The same functionality they carried from EBS to Fusion. Only have to understand how to manage the system process configuration, that you are going to understand. So you are not going to learn how to create invoice, how to make the payment, what setups need to be done for payables. Yeah, the same setups will be doing in the Fusion also, but there are certain changes, some naming conventions, some navigations, and how will be driving the process setups. The difference we have to understand. That would be enough to start with Fusion. So definitely if you have EBS,
yes.
Normally this training is only for the guys who has a EBS experience or knowledge. If somebody is here in the meeting who is something like fresher, they don't know about, they don't have any knowledge or experience on EBS, we don't recommend for them. The best thing what they can do is, if you want to do Fusion, first they can go with EBS learning, at least basics, then this course will suit. Even companies are also looking for the guys, consultants, who has EBS as well as Fusion experience. Because they should have flexibility to utilize the resource if required into a Fusion project, otherwise on EBS. Oracle is going to support this EBS up to 2030. So the reason consulting companies also will look for the guys whose experience talks about EBS and Fusion.
Okay, correct.
Yeah. Fine. Any other questions, please? Fine. Seems to no questions. So then that's all for today. Have a good day and good night. Thank you all.